quite pleased to return to my old school as an IMC. I studied architecture in Hong Kong U. Tonight, my wife Susan is with me. In fact, Xu Shang, almost clever, joined me to attend any public occasion. I don't know why she's so interested in attending tonight. It's a nice event. Probably Duke College is a very charming place to us. Albert just asked me whether I studied in any university hostel during my time in Hong Kong U. I said no, but in Duke College happened earlier during my time, I would seriously consider to choose a hostel life during my university days. And today I brought my friend here. It's called a Great Waster. In Chinese, I call it a high side way. When we proposed the waste policy to the lawmakers, the general criticism is that the government has been focusing too much on the hardware and not so much on education. So that's why I'm trying to be innovative and created this guy. It resembles a Chinese saying. Actually, in the Western world, they have similar saying is that for people with white eyes, that represent those people that they can think they could consume more food, but in fact, they have a narrow stomach, that they cannot consume that much. So with this saying that the designers create these big wasters under the quota, So it's not governed by Sarah, but I asked him whether he would like to come tonight. It hesitates because it knows that it's a green hostel here, and they think that the young people may not welcome him to come. Do you welcome him? Okay, tonight I would like to by sharing in two parts. Firstly, it's more my personal and also my family's experience about low carbon living. Second part would be about my 3 years experience in policy working in the government. In daily life, in Chinese, clothing, food, shelter, and also transportation represent our daily consumption and pattern of living. Firstly, I would like to start with clothing. Susan and I married for how long? More than 20 years. We have a daughter similar to your age. We seldom have argument, except one thing is that usually during my birthdays, she would buy me a new clothes, And I always complain and ask her that, Susan, I got enough clothes, what would make me happy is that is to make me have less rather than more. After years of complaint, now she is more conforming, but she just bought me two new clothes till my forthcoming birthday. In fact, for low carbon living in modern societies like Hong Kong, I think the saying less is more, or having less and being more meaningful should be the way forward for you and me. Secondly, about food, it's about food waste, so that's why we created this big waster. In Hong Kong landfills, the biggest waste in landfills, food-related stuff, accounting for about 40%, That's almost the largest share of solid waste in our landfills. It's a critical problem in Hong Kong. And to handle the food waste challenge in Hong Kong is more challenging in other places because in other places they have expensive farming that can consume the food waste for composting. With Qualcomm, even we would reactivate extensive farming due to limited land, etc. We can't consume our food waste a lot. So the most effective way is to reduce the food waste as source. I never waste food. I also teach my daughter what to waste food. And in Hong Kong, the most effective way is not to follow the waster and not to waste food during time. Okay? In Hong Kong, most of the food are wasted at home. Okay? Actually, all of the 3,600 tons of food waste per day, two-thirds upgraded at homes, and another one-third upgraded in commercial premises, including probably universities. So both have to be addressed. And I said, for example, not to waste any food. And when we boil Chinese soup at home, okay, we think what would be the best ingredients for the Chinese soup, so that I can consume all the stuff, calm down, okay, and minimize the wastage at home. Third is about shelter. I would like to highlight energy as the focus. In Hong Kong, even though it's not a big city, but our carbon footprint is not small, and that's not about climate change, etc., that we'd like to reduce our energy consumption. In Hong Kong, the biggest share of energy used are in buildings, accounting for about 60% of our carbon footprint in Hong Kong. Our home has internal ventilation, okay? About how to use energy, the particular space cooling, because at home, the biggest share of energy consumption related to air conditioning. In our living room, we do not have any air conditioning. Okay? We have been living there for around 20 years. Okay? It's still enjoyable with natural breeze and also with natural fan. In bedrooms, we do install AC, but the internal rule is that only if that night has temperature reported by Hong Kong Observatory with 28 degrees C or above is defined as hot light, then our members will have the option to consider this AC. And my recent bill is $101 a month. Okay, I can tell you that in Hong Kong, according to the data, on average at home, it's about per person $180 per month. That means for our family, three persons plus a maid, four persons, the average energy consumption should be about 180 multiplied by four, should be around 500 per month. But we said standard 100, okay? And in summertime, even we turn from AC to hot nights in bedrooms, it's about 20 years old. Okay. We'd like to take an example, I think that you can see last. Last is about our transportation. During weekends, we travel actually most of the time by mass transit, buses, or other public means. So you won't be surprised to meet me in an MTR or bus. Low carbon living is very important, and low carbon transportation is equally important. You can add that during our weekends, we are interested to go hiking, have local low carbon leisure activity. That can also trace back to my time when I dated my first girlfriend. You know, at that time, we are not as wealthy as today. So I thought that if I brought her to the country parks for hiking for a day, that would be very rewarding, right? Susan was my first girlfriend. these days, after marriage, we still spend a lot of time in country parks. That would be healthy and also low carbon. Okay, so what about my family and personal experience? I think you can copy and get a girlfriend and take her to country parks, so close to Hong Kong. I'm glad to take some time to share with you my experience in government for 3.5 years about policy making. Basically, we chose four areas as the key pillars for the Environment Bureau in these years. And for each of them, we published a comprehensive grouping, probably around a decade for each of them, set a target with very clear milestones and initiative to get close to the target. During our first year's term, we published the first ever clean air plan for Hong Kong. The target is to meet the heightened air quality objective largely by 2020 in this time. Okay? We have comprehensive schemes to phase out all lorries, to reduce the emissions from power plants, to regulate the emissions from ships, and also to tighten the collaboration with Guangdong. And the latest data tells us that Hong Kong's air quality has been improving in these few years. Okay? No matter it's general air quality or outside air problems. I can share with you two inside stories in relation to our air quality policy. Okay? One is about the phasing out of the old lorries. Okay? Our scheme going to use more than 11.4 billion to phase out more than 80,000 lorries in Hong Kong, or excessive, more than 80,000 diesel commercial vehicles in Hong Kong. That represents about 2/3 of the old diesel commercial vehicles in Hong Kong. That means out of 3 old commercial diesel vehicles, 2 will be phased out in a few years. That is one of the largest scale phasing out schemes in the world. It's very tricky. Because it's such a large physical scheme that would upset certain interests of stakeholders. Okay? The lawmakers would not be happy about that. When we formulate this policy, I can tell you that there are certain internal debates. Firstly, how much money that we can get from Zhongzhen, so, okay, to provide compensation for the phasing out. Okay? More than 10 billion is a huge sum for government. Second, do we have the political power or the capacity to phase out more than 80,000 vehicles within a few years? We can see similar examples around the world. When I was in the first year, I think we are more braver in a way. So we talked with our chief executive and asked for his support, okay, to get the funding to phase out the old lorries. It's not easy. Finally, we got through the internal process, and then we have to meet the lawmakers. You know, the lawmakers represent different interest groups. Some represent the car owners, some represent the one lorry grassroots people. So actually, we took one full year behind the scene before we present our policy to the Legislative Council. We meet different people, okay, including those people working in Kolam different market, and to convey them that for public benefit, that would like to set certain percentage of money for compensation and to phase them out within a certain period of time. And after long negotiation, got the support by the lawmakers, and now the cars are being phased out. Within the first year, around 40% of the old lorries have been phased out. So we can feel that along the roadside, Hong Kong's air quality has been improved. Second is about the emissions from ships. It's a surprise to many people, including Hong Kong people, is that in Hong Kong, now the biggest local air pollution source is from ships. No longer from power plants, no longer from vehicles. Because I think for control of the emissions of power plants, I think during the Sarah's day, the government, she has been reducing emissions. Okay, and set a very good foundation. And now, ships are the biggest emissions in Hong Kong in terms of air pollution. So in the last 2 years, we set two new laws. One is to regulate the fuel used by local vessels, local ships. That would help to some extent to clean up the emissions from ships. Secondly, we require all the big ships, the container vessels, called the ocean going vessels, when they are at berth in Hong Kong, they must use a much cleaner fuel. And Hong Kong, starting from this July, became the first city in the whole Asia with this law to require the ocean going vessels to use cleaner fuel at berth. That's very important for Hong Kong. The area like Taichung, Tsinghe, near the container ports, air quality has been improving significantly in the last half year. It's equally important not only for Hong Kong but also for the whole region, because Hong Kong set a good example for the whole Pearl Delta Rodong. I would like to follow the step of Hong Kong. And then with support by, from Beijing, I think the whole Pearl Delta's harbor become the first emission control area in the whole Asia, so that the whole region can enjoy much better air quality. So the message that we'd like to, for public health, we'd like to invest more by compensation and also by new laws to improve the public health. But one of the main issues is that when we propose the requiring ocean going vessels at berth to use cleaner fuels, there's a concern is that if Hong Kong is the first city to have that law, some ships would go to other nearby ports because the expenses for them would be higher in Hong Kong with the new regulations. So it's an interesting question, how to balance development, economy, and the environment. Okay. There's a proposal that we should wait and see. Okay, we should wait for Tianjin, we should wait for Zhao, so that these nearby ports can have a similar law around the same time, so that we do not lose business. But after a heated debate internally, I think at this time we won that Hong Kong would like to place a high emphasis on the environment. Okay, to some extent, we would lose certain business from these ocean going vessels and container ports, but we think that is good for Hong Kong in the long run. Okay, at the same time, we are pushing the leader by force to follow Hong Kong so that we can reduce the gap to business-making between Hong Kong and the mainland. The last policy making is about waste management, in particular food waste in Hong Kong. As I said earlier, food waste is the biggest source of solid waste in Hong Kong. We are taking a kind of approach embracing four elements. One is setting new law. Secondly is to set up the food wise campaign in Hong Kong with Big Waste as an icon, and we also provide recycling. At the same time, we are building up infrastructure to turn the food waste into useful resources. So it's kind of a four-pronged approach to address the food waste in Hong Kong. But the reality is that while we are investing in infrastructure to turn the food waste, say, into energy, that should be the future for Hong Kong. Planning and building each of these plants normally take a decade, okay, from inception to completion. So it's quite a long time to build up the capacity for us to consume the food waste and turn them into energy. Okay. So we need other initiatives that we can have them implemented within short time. Another thing is that lawmaking is a long process in Hong Kong. Okay, a cool example that now when you go to the supermarket, you guys should be using it to bring your reusable shopping bag. Okay, but by extending the first law related to the shopping bag that was implemented in 2009, and this year we extended to cover all the retail outlet, it took us 6 years to extend a relatively simple law. So law is important, but it takes us a long time. So we are drafting a law that would affect all waste issues, including food waste. It's the quantity-based waste charging that will affect your home, universities, and all the commercial activities. our plan is to put up the law to the council within our term. That would be around 2016 or 2017. That would have certain implications, but it takes a longer time. So the two short-term initiatives that could help us to reduce food waste is one is education, okay? Which each of us could reduce food waste at home or when you go off to Thailand, reduce food waste, that would help a lot. That would be most cost-effective, that would be most environmentally friendly. So that's why we try to be innovative, create this big waster, and he or she, okay, has his or her Facebook, okay, that she would like you to like him, okay, and to keep dialogue with him to promote the food waste culture of Hong Kong. At the same time, we set up a recycling fund for Hong Kong, that's the first ever funding in Hong Kong, that asked the recyclers to put up a proposal that can help us to reduce different recyclables to be wasted and landfill. And this recycling fund is just open for application, and we will have we'll see the result very soon. So that with the law to be being drafted, infrastructure being built, recycling fund to be a pilot, most immediate thing or actions that all of us can help is to reduce, is to change our behavior and reduce the waste whenever appropriate. What else can I say? Thank you, Jack. Okay. I think I said a lot about air and food waste. I would like to add more, two more things. One is about energy and climate change. Some of you may be aware that the Paris Climate Change Conference will be held very soon, from end of this month to mid-December. I think one of you are Suki, where are you? Okay. Join me in Paris. I think it's a very good move by Hong Kong to sponsor two students to attend this world conference. Climate change is a very important environmental issue facing all of us. So low carbon living is very important. By the government, we published two documents recently this year. One is the first ever energy saving plan for Hong Kong's built environment 2015 to 2025 plus. It's the first time that we set a new target to reduce our total energy consumption through device time management, in particular about buildings, because buildings in Hong Kong consume about 90% of our power in Hong Kong. As a 10-year plan, I would like to promote energy conservation in buildings. I'm very pleased to see Athena's proposal that can help you guys, to empower you guys that you understand your energy consumption, and then you can help to reduce energy. And the last document that we published last month is the Hong Kong's Climate Change Report 2015. It summarized what we've been doing about climate change with respect to mitigation, adaptation, and how to make Hong Kong a more resilient city. All these reports are, I would like to say, topic friendly. They are designed in a way very nice, with beautiful infographics. I would encourage all of you to take time to look at our kidnap plan, waste plan, food waste plan, and also medicine plan, the climate change report. All are beautifully designed with nice graphics, given my background as an architect, that could help those reports to be easily digested by the public. That's very important, because when I have been in the government for 3 years, I observe one thing is that it's not the most important if you have a different political stance or you have political, you have an other perspective. The biggest worry that always with me is that people are not really looking at the facts, not really having done enough research or understanding about the issue. They criticize before they really understand the problem. So that is the biggest issue. A large pattern. So probably we are having two means. One is publish this kind of blueprints so that those who are more willing to understand the issue could have a centralized way to easily understand the topic. The second attempt is that Greg Wasten set up his Facebook, and I my Facebook, and through this kind of Facebook, powerful social media tool, that we can also have dialogue and communication to minimize misunderstanding. With that, great wisdom, I'd like to encourage you to like or follow his Facebook. If you don't like his Facebook, bye bye. Thank you.